Hello and welcome to The Vote with me, Frank LaDuke, and my guests today, Councillor Robert Nemeth and Councillor Tom Druitt. Rob's Conservative, Tom Green from Brighton and Hove City Council. And I wanted to start by asking you about parking, first of all, and how we pay for it, because there are moves afoot I don't know, can I call them customer-friendly moves from your rivals who are not here, the Labour administration? perhaps one of you can take turns defending and one attacking them. I'm going to start with you, Tom, actually, because when the Greens were in office, they took out a lot of parking machines in the final stages of the administration. Why was that, first of all?
So there are a few reasons. I think the biggest reason, really, was that they sadly recently lost £3 million from CoinCo debacle, which I think we'll come on to later. But the main way that you can systematically reduce that risk is by reducing cash collection parking machines. And to be honest, personally, I'm not a massive fan of the pay-by-phone machines because they are quite difficult to use, to be fair. They also have an extra fee, which isn't a huge amount, but you know, it's just another one of those things.
It's a disincentive to switch from cash to phone.
On balance, I think it was probably the right decision to move away from cash payments in order to reduce the risk that the council could be stung again by the same kind of thing that happened with CoinCo.
And presumably when you've got a parking contractor, you've contracted with that company and those machines for a set period, so the sort of lifetime when you can replace them doesn't come. It's not like you can just say halfway through a contract, I want you guys to replace all the machines now. I'm guessing. I don't know. I mean, does that ring true for you?
No, the contractor doesn't replace the machines. The council's got to replace them, and it's taxpayers have got to pay for it.
Okay.
And my general thinking on the pay by phone, it was perfect when it worked alongside cash. I mean, there's plenty of people out there that loved the app. I mean, when it worked alongside the cash, it was fine. The problem was when you get rid of the machines, that various groups of the people that need to park find it very hard to park.
And sometimes hard to find a machine when there's fewer of them, presumably.
Well, you don't really need a machine if you're doing it by phone. Okay. But the problem is lots of people don't have the phones, lots of tourists can't be bothered to learn the system.
Yes, because they might be here for just a few days for a long weekend in Brighton.
Yeah, might be in a rush. There's all sorts of people. I mean, lots of elderly people just are not going to be able to learn this complicated new system.
I'm still trying to learn it.
Well, I've never used it, and I don't intend on using it.
To be honest, the system actually works very easily when you're set up.
Yep.
And then you can just fire off a text message in seconds, and you get a reply. It's very easy.
Yep.
It says, yeah, your parking's confirmed for an hour or 2 hours or whatever it is.
Yeah.
It also has benefits if you're stuck in a meeting and you know the meeting overruns,
yes,
or you're out in the shops and you have to do a bit more and you run out of time. You don't have to go back to the meter to put more money in. You can just send another text message, one more hour, job done.
Yeah.
The difficulty is when, if your phone's run out of battery or you've left it behind or whatever it is.
Yeah, no signal. Sometimes no signal.
No signal.
Yeah. But then, I can't believe that.
Yeah.
But then in every street there is still a cash machine.
I mean, Newchurch Road, though, is a mile long.
Probably is more than one in Newchurch Road. I don't know.
I hope there is.
Each street. But
and also, there's a lot of streets off Newchurch. I'd like to think with a lot of streets off
Newchurch
Road.
But there are also over 200 shops that take payments
as well.
Yeah.
So, the change that we're seeing, I think, if this is, I mean, by the time this is aired, this programme, the decision will have been made. And my suspicion is the council will have voted to have. Machines where you can pay by debit card, and I don't know if that's credit card as well, but certainly by debit card. An improvement?
Paying by debit card when you can't currently is a good thing, but it again comes back to getting rid of the cash.
So again, a good thing on two counts, more choice and more secure.
Yeah, I mean, my colleague on this committee, Councillor Tony Janio, our spokesman for transport, he's perfectly happy with the bit where you pay by credit card, because that's not taking anything away, that's adding a service. The problem is, if you take away the cash bit, that's the problem.
And I mean, is the cash bit being taken away completely? Is this part of what's
well of the 800 or so machines? 80% of them are going to lose the cash.
So we'll just
option.
Have and will it still be one per street with cash? Do we know?
Yeah, there's not going to be any further machine losses. They're just going to be changed to solely credit card. 80% of them.
So we can still expect some discontent from some drivers?
Yeah, I mean, we've already changed it, the system, quite a lot. It takes people quite a while to get used to it.
Yeah. So. I mean, because it wasn't that many years ago, we had the sort of what I call the scratch cards. I never won. but we had the scratch cards you could buy in
scratch card again. Where you always lose.
But you get an hour's parking. I mean, you know, that's you know, in Brighton that's worth a lot. I mean, in some parts.
Yeah.
Are we putting off tourists? The people who come here and find it a faff to park. It's just one more thing, and it's, we're not a cheap place to park. I mean, in Hong Kong you can park for a day cheaper than here, and it's a pretty densely populated place.
I think the chance of people having a bank card in their wallet is higher than the chance of them having the right coinage in their pocket. So for tourists, I think this change is actually an improvement.
Is there not a case for saying we should have these machines where you can actually have the option to pay by phone, by card or by cash? And actually there's a discount if you're going to pay by card or phone to incentivise people not to use cash, because it saves the council money. The more cash that's collected, the more it costs the council. Therefore, we ought to be incentivising people to think about alternatives to cash, actually, rather than sort of clobbering them if they pay by phone, which there is an extra charge at the moment.
I like that idea. I think you should stand for council, Frank.
They'd be mad to have me.
I agree. We agree with that.
Yeah, no, there's a lot of nonsense in here as well. But I mean, I don't know. It just seems to make sense that, you know, it seems to be a little bit back to front at the moment. And I guess I sense that introducing card payments is progress, but it is one step forward, and we could probably do better.
I think you hit the nail on the head when you talk about the cost of collection, because that's really the biggest problem. In an ideal world, people would be offered pay by phone, text message, debit card, cash, you know, whatever, at every machine in the whole street.
Yeah.
But the costs of offering that are high.
And
would people be willing to pay a little bit extra for parking? You know, maybe not. Maybe people would actually thank the council for trying to do it in the most efficient way, so that the cost of parking is kept.
I mean, it is a very sensitive area, the cost of parking, particularly for those who have little choice. I mean, if you're a tradesman around the city, a plumber, a carpenter, electrician, or whatever, you haven't got a choice about carting your tools around, etc. And I know many people do have a choice, but like care workers, for example, they've got to get to places. They've got very little time between calls, and the more time they have to spend trying to find someone to park, pay for it, and all the rest of it, the more that comes out of their wages, the less time they get caring for the people who need it. So there actually is a great deal of sense in trying to make parking not, you know, it seems to have been a policy of the council over a number of administrations to make parking a difficult thing. Is the public perception, I suspect, for some people, and that perhaps, you know, is this a one step in the direction of actually trying to ease the situation a little? I know it's hard to praise the administration that's not.
I don't know any administration of any colour that has tried to make parking difficult just for the sake of it. That has been the public perception. I think the Argus has a lot to answer for in terms of stoking up people's anger around parking. But
my suspicion is they'll kind of reflect what's coming into the inbox, which is the sort of, and you know, people do get exercised. I mean, it is one of those.
It's a hot topic.
And traders' permits were double.
A flashpoint. Really.
I mean, Tom and I both serve on the Economic Development Committee, and I suppose when we weren't councillors, we didn't have that brief, but now we'd probably have to stick up for traders if we heard that. I mean, I did. I spoke at full council about it, but it does slightly conflict with the Green position on motorists, doesn't it?
I think there's a great deal of sympathy for wanting to get people to switch from their cars to cycling and walking places. And that has happened, again, under successive administrations of different colours. We have seen a switch in Brighton.
Yeah, I think the City Council has tried to improve options for walking and cycling and public transport. A huge amount more needs to be done. We're not even remotely halfway yet in terms of where we need to be.
People associate that with the Green Party, but actually it's, I mean, I probably might be surprised to hear your, I mean, you mentioned Tony Janu earlier, who speaks for your party on this committee. I mean, I've often heard him speak up for things like motorcycling and cycling, for example, which might surprise people, because and Graham Cox, when he was on the previous council, again, was quite in favour of a lot of things that discourage driving.
We generally take the view that if you build, they will they will come. So we wouldn't want to penalise motorists, we would rather put in a good cycle lane, make it easier to walk.
But it's, again, we've got quite a lot of challenges. Yeah. Not just all your colleagues would agree.
I'm glad Robert said that, because
not all his colleagues would agree.
Don't ruin my
remember.
Story. Don't ruin my story.
that wasn't the case on Grand Avenue.
Always.
A number of years ago, I think we've moved on since then.
Yeah, we do, and I think there also there are
and
issues.
And we lost the council.
There are issues about where is the right place to build cycle lanes. I mean, perhaps this is not probably the programme for them. We'll take a break in a second, but I think some of the practical issues are about where we build them and, you know, the balance between road and car space. Let's take a quick break. Don't go away. Join us after these ads. And I want to ask you about that sort of cash debacle with Coinco, where we are with that, and one or two other things about parking. So, see you in a few minutes. Hello and welcome back to The Vote with me, Frank LeDuc, and Councillor Tom Druitt and Councillor Robert Nemeth from Brighton and Hove City Council. Touched on parking in the first half of the programme. There's another sort of parking related issue that's coming up, which is that caravans or non-motorised vehicles, which have been the subject of complaints in some parts of Brighton and Hove, are going to be tolerated a lot less if the decision that's taken after we filmed this, but before we broadcast it, goes ahead. So what's going to change, Robert?
I'm sure this will go through, by the way. What's going to change is that unmotorised vehicles will be banned from the public highway. And this has come about...
In terms of being parked?
In terms of being parked, yep, exactly. Yeah, they can drive around still. this has come about because some residents might find, you know, five, ten vehicles on their street outside the house, such as on Surrenden Road, I think would be a good example. You know, whole stretches of vehicles, and they could be left for 6 months, or I suppose they could be left. I had one left near me for even longer, in fact. So that's why it's come about. People took advantage of a system, and when we have massive pressures on parking, it was inevitable that it would spill out, and a tough decision would have to be made.
An area that's a commanding cross-party agreement?
I'm not 100% sure, to be honest, but...
We'll have to wait and see tomorrow how it pans out on the committee. But I think, I'm broadly in favour of the proposals to remove things that have been abandoned, essentially.
Yes.
Interestingly, on the Brighton Hove News website, there was a picture of...
Very good website here.
I've heard it's one of the best. there was a picture of a burger van or whatever it was. And one thing that I think I would be looking to ensure that sole traders who have a burger van or
ice cream van,
you know, they're not just going to be towed away or clamped or something without talking to those traders.
So it's making sure we know what kind of vehicles
Does
the policy include them? Well, because that's a motorised vehicle.
No, it's a trailer.
Oh, trailer, okay.
So if you're
trading from your trailer rather than from the actual... Yeah. So because the ice cream vans tend to be, it's all one vehicle, but... I mean, we saw the problem down the seafront for quite a while. I mean, it's been, as you say, I think as the parking schemes have rolled in, the controlled parking zones, it's been displaced further out.
Not the same problem as by the King Alfred. That's lived in vehicles, a different problem.
And they're motorised as well.
They don't
fall foul of these changes.
No, they don't.
Is there a problem? Some people complain that they're there for sometimes quite long periods and they don't seem to be affected by parking rules the same way as everybody else.
No, it's the same. They're not breaking the rules. There's a black market for residents' visitor permits.
Okay.
So they tend to have permits now.
Okay.
The situation there has changed. You could, I suspect, get tough on residents who who trade their permits. Yeah.
I mean, which is feasible. You don't need any change of policy to do that, presumably.
Well, you don't, but I suspect when the new King Alfred's built, this fixes that problem anyway, which is quite unique in the city. There's not many spots where you can get right up to the sea and live there.
I mean, I'm mildly jealous. If I didn't have a home, you know, I'd probably sort of think there's an alternative lifestyle. That's quite appealing. Wake up, go in the sea.
Well, I've got a mate on Osborne Villas who's selling a few permits if you want
to. No, that's very kind of you, but I think that would be very illicit and very bad. Right.
I used to live in a van. And,
did you?
And it's not all it's cracked up to be.
but it's chilly in winter.
Two winters. Well, I say it was a van. It was actually a yellow bus. but Yeah, two winters.
Parked, I'm told you have one or two yellow buses.
Parked in our depot. Okay. But yeah, it's very cold.
Yeah,
you've got to have very limited options.
I mean, I take it a lot of the people who live in vans, caravans, etc., are people who are effectively priced out of the property market in many respects. I mean, I'm not sure that's the pattern.
I don't think it's as simple as that.
Summer lifestyle choices, you say?
It doesn't mean they're rich or poor, but it's summer lifestyle decision.
Okay. I mean, one of the things that is a sort of that again is another flashpoint that's coming up at the moment is the traveller site and the return of travellers as the warmer months come. At Horsdene, we've got the new traveller site opening shortly. Is that going to solve people's concerns about travellers pitching up and camping in parks in the city, for example, on sports fields, that kind of thing? Solve the problem?
Well, it's probably not going to solve the problem in one go. It'll certainly help. And one of the problems that the council has had in the past is that it's had difficulty moving people on from parks because there's nowhere to move them on to.
Yeah.
This will solve that. So at least now, you know, if somebody rocks up in Wild Park, there'll be somewhere else to send them.
To direct them to.
But, you know, I think there are some people that would argue that from a cultural perspective, they're, you know, a permanent traveller site isn't exactly what they had in mind. You know, as traditions of travelling have evolved.
There are a lot fewer places for travellers to stop compared with the old days. As we've become more developed, I mean, as a country, and including Brighton and Hove as well, and there are a lot fewer stopping places.
A lot fewer stopping places, and that's a problem. So we do need to try and create as many permanent and also temporary sites as we can in areas that can sustainably.
That's very hard in a place like Brighton and Hove, though, isn't it? When there's such huge competition with what we do with the space. Jim, what have we got at Horsdene? Do you know? We've got a temporary transit site and we've got a permanent site now on the same plot.
Yeah, Tom didn't say anything that's incorrect, but the problem is if it's full up, we're then back to square one. So you only need it to be full. Another group turns up and then you can't move them on because that could be full. So
I mean, they can be moved on, but for other reasons. They can't be directed to the.
But immediately. I mean, you can't move them on immediately. That's the problem.
I think sometimes people get cross with the council and rail against the police for not using their powers to move people on.
But yeah, actually, I do as well.
But there are constraints on what the police and the council can do, and there are also things that they by law they're expected to do to fulfil their obligations, if you like. So that there's, you know, part of being a fair society, even though it can be deeply irritating to people who feel inhibited from. Mm. Walking their dog or can't play the sports they've paid, pitch hire, for example.
What I do agree with Tom over is, like, from the beginning, I was hoping that the council could help the travelling community to set up their own sites that they own, that they take pride in, that they're in charge of properly.
There are some in Surrey, aren't there, where they've done this?
No, it's a fairly common thing. There's others around Sussex, but it doesn't strike me as in the spirit of the travelling lifestyle to go almost cap in hand to the council in a designated spot with a brand new perfect driveway, like a campsite. That doesn't seem in the spirit of things, in my mind. I mean, you know what the council's like. It was 10 times more expensive than it should have been. I mean, they spent more per pitch, which is essentially a piece of concrete and a toilet, than it takes to build a 3-bedroom house in Port Slade.
Well, that brings me on in a way to another aspect about council. The question was raised at
£200,000 per pitch.
That does seem extraordinarily excessive.
Although I have to say again, perhaps slightly in defence, there's been a lot of engineering work that's needed to take place because of concerns raised about how the runoff and so how diesel, for example, might. Diesel or chemicals like bleaches might get weather.
But that's a good reason why you don't build on the South Downs National Park.
Certainly by our aquifers and our water supply, but I'm sure that's added to the cost. But the whole question of how the council manages its funds, I mean, we touched on at the start Coinco and the cash collection contractor that went bust owing the council more than £3 million. We've had the Mears subcontractor that led to the council being overcharged by hundreds of thousands of pounds. That money has now all been recovered, I understand, unlike the Coinco cash. Mm. How can we be sure the council is managing our money well, spending it well, etc.? You know, what steps do we need to take that we're not taking now, or what do we need to do better?
Well, The Coinco contract's a good example because Land Security's biggest property company in the country, they didn't have this problem. They had the problem of Coinco not sending them the funds, but they were straight on the case. I guess they probably sent someone straight to their office and said, what's going on?
And so they recovered instantly most of on their the case. Money.
I think they got all their money. But that's a good example of how it should be done. So I couldn't say exactly what the steps are. But
better contract monitoring, basically.
Well, yeah, however Land Securities did it, that's how we should do it.
And I think really what needs to be done is that the system that's set up needs to be bomb-proof from the start. So what we had with Coinco was they collected money from the council and put it into a bank account. It wasn't the council's bank account. Why could they not have just deposited it in the council's bank account at the end of the day?
Yeah.
So there would be no need for, you know, agreements around, okay, it stays in our account for 10 days or whatever it is, and then
presumably that process reduced the price of the contract, because these are expensive. It's expensive to pay someone to get your money for you, bizarrely.
Yes, but you know, you get what you pay for, don't you?
And this was the second contractor in a row that went bust.
Totally.
Okay. Yeah. Do you feel confident that steps are now being taken so that the current contractor, for example, and things like the arrangement with Mears are better? I mean, it's going to have to be a quick yes and no because we're going to wrap up in a second, but
yes,
we're moving in the right direction.
Yes. We're definitely moving in the right direction. I haven't seen anything that's categorically showed me that this cannot happen again, which is a worry.
Okay, well, I'm sure you'll both be on that along with your colleagues on the council. Thank you very much for joining us both.
Thanks, Ray.
And I hope you come back up very soon, because I want to talk about some other things too. Join us again on The Vote very soon. Goodbye for now.